checking out some escapes from the guillotine choke. Now, a lot of people will say, well, I'll never get in there and everything else like that. If you never get in there, you've never actually grappled hard. You've never actually fought somebody in the street, things like that. These are places you will get to. Even if you're just horsing around and playing around, these are escapes from getting out of that. They're dangerous insofar as they can get your opponent in a superior position, you're bent over, and they can choke you out. So we're going to look at some escapes from this. So very first things first, when this comes across, the very first thing we look at, whenever somebody puts their hands up underneath here to do this, the meaty part of the thumb is on top. It's rare that people will do this and somehow twist their hands that way. Even if they do, it doesn't matter. You're going to still grab the palm at the meaty part of the either pinky or thumb, depending on which one they have, but most likely it'll be the thumb. And you stop the advance of the choke. And the advance of the choke in this case is the hands bind together and then they rise up. So that's what we have to watch out for. We can't allow that to happen. Whether my hand is here, whether this is going in here, we're looking at the same side hand that's doing this. So if this hand is coming across and wrapping my head, then this hand will deal with that. So same side. So in this particular case, I stop the advance of the choke. The other things that I have to pay attention to are my posture. Your posture has to be where your head is supported by your feet. I cannot sit there and expect my escapes or anything else I do to be successful if my head is over my feet. I'll fall down. They will instantly feel my imbalance. It will not be a problem for them. So if I'm going like this, I'm supported here. Second, my butt is out and my back is arched. I do not want to round out and I do not want to bend forward like this with my head down. Butt out, back arched, head starting to work in an upward position. That facilitates moving your hips in fast to work the escapes. So, first and foremost, I do a couple of things here. She's feeling it right now, but you're not seeing it. If we go and look at this, I'm driving my shoulder into where she puts her other hand. So you can see where, as this locks, I push this in here, and my shoulder actually will impede her raising the her arms up. That's something you don't always see. And she'll feel it though, and you will feel it if you're working this properly. So I'm in here like this. I've got my post supporting my head's position. I've got my head. I'm going to start up like this. The very first one that we're going to do is I'm going to take my arm at the elbow. So you can see from here, I have to get my elbow wrapped around the shoulder. This is not one where you can sit there and just use your hands to grip and expect to pull. Wrap it across, let it lie over like that. Enjoy the full feel of all the surface area contacting the opponent. You're going over their shoulder, and the head will come up. Now I'm going to put my ear on the opponent, and then I'm going to take my rear foot, spin it back, and then drop down on that foot as I allow my arm to pull down. One of the key factors is getting that arm over the top. If you think about grabbing somebody just with the hand, you've got a lot more linkage. That means a lot more freedom of movement for your attacker. So when you bind them, your arm goes over the shoulder line like that. Now, any movement I make with my upper torso or my hips dropping will cause a full movement that doesn't require a bunch of bicep control, forearm flexor control. This is folding it over, wrap, position, head up, turn my ear onto my opponent, and I keep looking in that direction. Again, I'm removing the hand just so you can hear me. And I lock this head up. My hand, I don't even have to grab with my fingers. I'll place it on there because it's more surface area making contact. but I don't have to because that shows how the elbow over the arm or shoulder works. I drop like this and I look up. And I continue looking up. And then I drive my hips down to the ground. This is extremely important. That body slam. And I will continue my hip pressure. Now, a lot of people are worried about getting this off. Don't worry about getting this off your head. People will sacrifice their posturing, their good position, a lot of other things to try to get this off. It's not doing anything, so don't worry about it. It's just holding me here, but she's in a worse position, I guarantee you. Get in here, put as much pain compliance as you can on the person. Sometimes they can't get the hand up, and that's perfectly okay, because while they're still hooked here, I'm bringing this off. Okay. Right there. Again, this is being nice. It'd normally be, you know, setting that in. My head is up like this, and I want to just drive this way. She's going to tap. And that's because my head is up, and I'm looking that way. She'll feel it even just there. She'll feel that. The other thing that I have to do is I'll drive my shoulder into her throat. So my arm over the top shifts a little bit so that I can bind the head. And I drive the shoulder right in. Now, if you're worried about getting bridged, you just swing the other foot over like that, which also sets up for the mount. Number two. First one was here. Second one, we're going to do a punch at the hip. Again, same mechanics, same hand that's coming over here. My same hand will stop the advance of the choke. And this one has to be done fairly quickly as this is put on. It's not one that you're going to get a lot of success on if they're already driving their hips in, arching their back, and starting to work this. That's harder to do. So before they get to that position, this one you punch in at the hip. Now, this is a joint that moves. If we hit with enough force, and I'm not like hitting it, I'm actually using it more of a push. My mentality has to be that my head has a pen on it. Imagine a pencil coming out. And I want to trace my top of my head onto the person's body. So if we turn her around this way, as I come out like this, I keep the bind on the arm. You notice I'll come out and into. I'm going to stab her in the throat with a pen or a pencil that I have on the top of my head. Again, use whatever visualization works for you. From this position, I switch out the arm. I keep driving forward and move. I switch out. I bind nice and tight. I push my chest forward, pull the arm back, pull this one back, and I drive my shoulder forward. And it's a shoulder lock. It's a Russian arm tie. So this will tear the shoulder out. Don't go fast on these because it will tear. It doesn't look like much or that it will possibly could do that, but it does. If you've experienced this fast, you're gonna tear something. So one right there, you're binding, lock it, secure it, and go. Now people will think, oh, if I'm in this position, you know, that hand is free to punch me. Well, you gotta remember, when I'm coming out here, first of all, I'm going here and I'm slamming forward. So that's my first hit, is headbutt. Most people aren't aware of how to keep their head positioned when somebody's doing this. Second, I will tear the shoulder before they throw a punch. If they throw the punch and I rip this, I swear to you they're gonna stop their punch mid-track because of the pain that comes into play from tearing off somebody's shoulder like that. So from here, setting up.
Punch, drive,
position lock.
Okay. It's really important that you stay squatting, you stay with control. When I'm in here, punch, bind, switch out, drive. Your head has to go in that direction. I'm not doing anyone any favors if I try to go like this and pull out like this with my head down.
well, I'm not doing myself a favor, it'll help her. If I go like that, she's gonna keep the lock.
It's not hard for her to do, especially if her hands are clenched. We're opening this up so you can see better.
But when I go back like this, it's not gonna help me get out of the lock. So if I'm trying to do this, I have to immediately, as soon as I come past the hip, I press in, and then you see where I'm looking. I'm looking back. I want to look back to the top of my skull. I want to see her spine. I want to go back, looking back that far. Where I direct my head is where I'm going to direct the opponent. So I'm looking back, bam, boom. That sets up, you have to pay attention to how you're doing this. One of the key factors, and it seems silly, and it seems a little unreal that it'll work, but when you're actually working this and you're binding people and you look back, you change where your vision is going, your body picks up the motion. Your back arches properly, your spine is in alignment properly, and it supports the rest of your body tools. This one's dangerous for your opponent. You can't really do this one full speed. When this, again, one of the big keys about this is when they lock, there's a couple of things. One is they lock, they pull their hips in, they arch their back, and work the choke with your head caught in between here. So one of the main things that you want to do is you want to stop the advance of the choke. You're pulling it downward. A lot of people come inside like this. You don't have as much strength. This one relies more on your tricep engagement, trying to push that down. If you do it this way, you've got an underhook which uses the bicep and pulls your engages your latissimus dorsi, your lats, a little earlier and better. So when this is coming through here, if what we're going to do on this particular escape, we're going to push my chest into her at the same time as I'm pulling down here. Now I'm going to bind and wrap her arms through this process, and that's going to make it almost impossible. And I've done this with very big guys, strong guys, trying to pull that up, and they can't do it. So your goal is, as soon as this comes around, you stop the advance of the choke, and then you bind. So in here, if I can't go around completely on this here, meaning I can't capture that arm, that's perfectly okay, because they're binding it with their fists together in a chain link, or however they want to handle that. And so what you're going to do is you're going to wrap completely around. You're going to push your chest forward. Again, I don't do any of this without my foot being supportive of my head. My head is going to go up. Again, bind, chest forward. I'm really squeezing my elbows down into my sides, and that traps her arm. My chest in here is riding over her forearm, and it's keeping it. So if she tries pulling up, and again, you do this with bigger, stronger guys too, this works. You catch it before it gets up here on the throat. So anything that's coming around, rarely are you going to be unaware of an arm coming around your head. So you aren't going to have this be an immediate lockout. And if they do bring it around, your first goal is to drop it down by capturing it here. Then in this particular one, like I said, my chest is already engaged. My shoulder first, my chest second, wrap, and now I really bind it. Now this is where it's dangerous for your opponent, because my goal is to slam backwards, and she has no way to stop her fall. So I will basically slam her on her head. So in this position, when we're looking from here, we're looking at this. I'm dropping, my hips go in, bind, hips, head, looking back. As I fall, I rotate onto my stomach. Now, if I'm really nasty, I just keep it on a side position and just drive the head into a neck crank to where they do some severe damage. So again, that's one that you can't go fast on. That's one that you just can't, you have to be very careful with that one. It comes in here, bind, wrap, head up. I don't have to lift the person. All I have to do is use my head as a guide to drive them. So if I'm using my eyes to look as I'm going down, we're gonna go really slow so I don't bury her face. I look, I look, I look. Okay, so from here we're going to go, we've got the capture, let's stop the advance of the choke, head up, hips in. Then I do a couple of things. This is the sequence of events. You want to do ear, cheek, forehead, and then side.
You're working that control around the person's body, but the mechanics for it, you have to really get your head involved. You're going to have strong neck muscles if you're doing this right. So ear touches down first, then your cheek, then you roll your forehead.
Comes through here, boom, just like that. I don't care about this. This is just a holdover. I'm not actually maintaining this and flicking it out. This is just done in a very fast movement. My head comes up like this, hips are in, ear touches down. I work binding around, cheek touches. I roll my forehead, and then I reattach. And some guys and girls are big. You have to do a chain link fence, a chain link grip, so where your fingers are just working this. But either way, you're to their back, and then it's a matter of striking, tailbone shots, things like that. So it's really, you get their back. But this one's more violent than the other one. But you have to have the body mechanics in there with your head to cause your spine to arch properly and to get in that motion. So from here, it's like that.
Hips are a big key on that one.
Hips are immensely important on this one. If I'm going through here
and I'm trying to do this with this, but my hips are back, it won't work. Especially with somebody who's strong, somebody who's got a lot of familiarity with this, it just isn't going to work. So you've really got to drive your hips in with the head arching back towards them.
If you think about your head initially coming back here, you're actually looking back toward their spine and about this area. You're going to look back to that and cause your body motions to move in there. But hip forward. This is one of those that you can't skimp on. It's got to be there. Anytime you're trying to lift somebody who's heavier, you have to have your hips under you for the lift.
Now this one is just a little bit of an alternative. So this one comes through. It's the same scenario. The only thing I'm going to do is I'm going to jam the leg. I'm going to basically slam a knee into the upper thigh to drop the leg back. And so, pop.
Then the rest is continue as the previous one. This has a nice effect because it tends to drop them off their base. It tends to disturb them. If you look at our Rebel Wing Chun, this is part of our Rebel Wing Chun attack sequences, things like that. So we come in through here, I drive, everything else is the same, but following this arc, instead of just working around like this, I kick through, and again here, my knee, I'm going to be nice on this one, but bam, just like that. It's knee and hip, so I'm actually working thigh and hip, like that. That's going to make it work. Don't just do this and leave the hips back here, because this escape requires the hip involvement. So you have to come forward like that. So if I'm in here like this, yeah, right there. And your hip has to, head has to stay attached to their back for the simple reason a lot of people fling their elbows back, sometimes purposely, sometimes not. So if I'm back here like this, she throws an elbow from the other side. Boom. She's set. Throws it from this side. This side. So it's just not, you're safe that way. If you're behind them and you're looking up to see how well you're doing, it's pretty much assured you're going to be sleeping through that whole discovery.
Okay, this one is the sidestep. So everything else is the same as before. The only difference is, as she tries to bind, I'm going to wrap. Stop the advance of the choke. We're going to move this way a little bit. Stop the advance of the choke. This time I'm going to look back where I had said I was going to look like before, into her spine and then beyond. Now, my arc has to go this way and down. I cannot just continue in a straight line. That's where people will fail in this. So, and this one is just a sidestep. This one uses just a kinjit type maneuver from the front. So, I will be stepping through here, driving my head in the same motion. I can slap out ahead of them if I want to spare them a lot of danger or damage. Or I can just allow my shoulder to land on them for a solid hit. It's really painful. Some of these I've done against a rather big guy, strong grappler, stocky, with the red man outfit on, because I wanted to test how hard these hits were. And I did that once on one particular drop down and shoulder line to center. The guy couldn't get up for about 5 minutes, and that's through a red man with chest plate. It's really, really, with trauma plates on it, it's really, it's powerful. Don't forget this. When you're in a fight, everything is part of your weapon, your head, knuckles, elbows, forearms, bicep shots, shoulders, it's all there. Shoulders are a great weapon and they're a great defensive structure. So, coming through here again. This one's just a sidestep, head up, defend the choke, big step, kinjit, which comes in here, and then I buckle to the side at the same time as I'm driving my head. A lot of people will, they don't want to go to the ground. And sometimes in the street you can't avoid that if you've got two people, three people, things like that. But one thing you want to make sure of, if you're working to get this person down and you don't want to go with them, you've got to get this off. That's where you will want to look at our wrist locks series and things like that. We've got a video that just details not only how to put the locks on, but how to escape from all of them. So when you're coming in here and you want to get out of this, this is where finger locks, everything else will come into play to help you not go down to the ground. But in those cases where you want to, because you want to make an impression on your attacker, you'll step through and then you'll slam. Remember, eyes are in play. And slam with the chest, or at the shoulder, you slam hard. Bam. And always be aware of, if they're jiu-jitsu trained, just keep your body back. Typically, I will not use my hands to defend legs if I'm on a street situation, a street fight. You have to use forearm or elbow and body positioning. The hips have to go back on their own, or they've got to come in and take care of the business, because you may be being kicked from somebody else on the side and you have to defend your head. Okay, the next one is very similar to that. The first one was in here like this, and you kinjit, you step front and drive. That one doesn't require too much drive, simply because you buckle the leg down pretty nicely and they're crossing their center line as you bring the leg into play. This one we're going to do, it's a sidestep capture. So I've got to stop her post. And this is something that you have to really work. Bigger guys, taller guys that have a lot of muscle, you can't sit there and go high on the thigh on this one. You have to go, you find where the knee is, and you have to go slightly above that. That's all. Don't go below the knee, because the knee is a joint, it'll bend, you will lose traction. So in this position, everything else is the same. I'm looking in that direction. I want to take her down. We're going to go here. This one requires me a step at the same time as I capture this leg and go down. So big step, capture, then drop. This one's even more hard hitting us with the shoulder onto the chest than the previous one was. This one, again, you have to be nice going down, because you will damage them. Any other questions? Subscribe. I give my subscribers preference on if they have any questions or they have anything that I can answer via email, contact@corejkd.com, and I will respond. And if you're a subscriber, I may produce a video for you.